Thank you very much. At the time of writing, I was a PhD student in the University of Strathclyde, and I recently graduated like 3 days ago. So today, I'm going to talk about improving the energy efficiency in ships with the use of building energy simulation. I'll start with saying why energy efficiency is needed in ships. I'll say a few things about the current design regulations of ship HVAC systems. Then I'm going to compare ships and buildings and see what are the similarities and differences between those two. I'll say a few things about the current state of building energy simulation and how it's used in the building industry. And then I'm going to talk about what I did during my PhD and what's in this paper. The crux of this paper, which is transforming energy simulation tools in order to be applicable in a marine environment. And then I'm going to finish with a case study presenting how the marinized BESS tool can be used to improve the energy efficiency in ships. Okay, the considerable amount of greenhouse gas emissions and the related diseases, along with the wide fluctuation in fuel prices, have led to the introduction of mandatory environmental regulations in shipping that came into force in 2013. This has shifted the focus of the shipping community towards energy efficiency. The way to improve the energy efficiency of ships can be done with the use of alternative or greener fuels like gas, biofuel, LNG, and the integration of renewable energy sources onboard ships, like PVs, kites, etc. Now, both of these categories, all the measures in these categories, haven't been, the economic feasibility of them has not yet been tested, and the rules and regulations are to be developed for their safe design and operation. This is why fuel oil is likely to remain the main energy source in ships for at least the next 30 to 40 years. So the most prominent energy efficiency measures in ships at the moment is the reduction of the power demand. This can be done with several operational and technical measures. Now, the current design regulations for HVAC systems in ships are characterized by a lack of transients. By that I mean that instead of assessing the time and power variation of the systems, all systems are designed based on a single point in time. Usually, this single point is an extreme design point, which means when we want to size a heater, we take a temperature of minus 20 degrees Celsius. And when we want to size a cooler, we say 35 degrees of Celsius and 90% of humidity. Then there is an inaccuracy in heat transfer calculations. So instead of using heat transfer coefficients that change in time, we have steady state coefficients that do not take into consideration the variation of ambient parameters like the wind speed, the change in sea temperature, etc. Then there are several simplifications. Radiation exchange, for example, between the ship hull and the sky is not considered. And also, during the design process, there is no interaction between the systems. So, there is when you actually want to assess the energy performance, you design the HVAC systems, see how much power it needs to operate, how much heat it can reduce or add to the space. Then you take the space in a different step and see how much energy is lost and if the energy that is being supplied can make up for the loss of energy through the ship hull, walls, and adjacent cabins. Now, all these are is evidence that the current design regulations lead to oversized and inefficient systems. Now, in other industries, such as the building industry, they have been focusing on improving the energy efficiency for many years, and building energy simulation has been used to improve the energy performance, to actually assess the energy performance of buildings in the system, and improve their energy efficiency. Also, since building energy simulation has been evolving since the 50s to reach to its current mature form, it has recently been involved in policy making as well. So during the commissioning process that Mr. Paraskevopoulos was speaking earlier, there are several steps that where building energy simulation might be used to assess the performance of the energy systems in buildings. Stemming from those similarities between ships and buildings, my research focused on investigating the applicability of building energy simulation in ships in order to assess the energy performance of onboard systems and improve them. Now, this is a figure that Dimitris there will be familiar with. So these are all the interactions that occur inside a space. So here we have the air point node, which is a node that represents the air volume inside the room. You can see that there is convection of walls with external environment, external long-wave radiation with adjacent buildings, infiltration from outside, casual gains from lights, people, all of you here. So all of these have been taken into consideration and have been modeled in the major tools out there. Now let's see what are the differences between ships and buildings that affect the energy simulation in a marine environment. First of all, there is a difference in construction materials. In ships, the materials that can be used are dictated by safety and stability requirements. So a designer cannot just select a random material and put it in there. Then there is a wide space, the wide range of space configurations, which means that you can have a cabin and a huge theater next to it. Because, of course, the ship is alone somewhere in the ocean, so it needs to have everything on board. So having said that, you might have the engine rooms that contain mechanical equipment, which emits huge amounts of radiation and may affect the conditions in adjacent spaces. Since ships travel around the world, and unlike buildings, their orientation can change, which means that you have different solar angles impacting different solar angles for the radiation that impacts the walls. And also there is a change in the geographical location, which means that by changing the latitude and the longitude of our model, several parameters that are of interest change, such as, again, the time that the sun is up in the sky, the angles with which the solar radiation hits the ship. Then you have adverse weather changes when you are at sea, which means that maybe faster control techniques should be implemented. There is a different occupancy profile. So if we're talking about a cruise liner or any commercial ship, I'm only saying commercial because my research was focused in commercial. Maybe that applies to naval ships as well. All the people are on board at all times, which means that there might be heavy occupancy in certain hours in restaurants, for example, in theaters at night. So during modeling, that has to be taken into consideration in order not to oversize systems. And then we have several physical phenomena that need to be included in the modeling process, such as heat transfer between the sea and the ship. Oops. And this, I don't know why it's not here, this should be reflectivity, solar reflectivity from the seawater to the ship hull. Now, what the building energy simulation tools can do? First of all, they're systemic, so you have different systems that make the whole building. that are integrated in one big energy model, let's say. Then you have the tools capture the dynamic occurrences, which means that parts may involve in at different rates. So you might have an airflow network, and there you would need changes of a time step of about 10 minutes, maybe less, 5 minutes. While when we're talking about the temperature changes in the room, we would be talking about 1 hour time step. So these are all taken into consideration, and you have interaction between the systems at different time rates. Then there is non-linearity, which means the parameters are not steady state, and they evolve in time. And then there is a complexity, which means that everything has to be taken into consideration during modeling and simulation. Now the software that was used, which I was not allowed actually to present, it was given as a comment to remove from a presentation, but basically all the major tools out there, they are based on a finite volume conservation approach, which means starting from first principles, modeling all the physics of a building, and then those, let's say, equations that are formed describe the whole problem. Now, in my case, I won't be mentioning the software, that's not of importance. So let's continue to what I did to actually marinize a building energy simulation tool. So the first thing that I did, I mentioned it over there. So the first thing that I did was to update the database of material and construction databases of building tools with ship materials and constructions. Then, yes, that was my argument as well, but I didn't continue with that. Anyway. What do you mean? The physical materials. In the physics, like the things that you find in handbooks. I cross-checked with manuals as well. I'll expand a bit later on that. Then I categorized the ship spaces because I wanted to provide some sense of modularity. So when we're talking about designing a deck with, let's say, four small cabins, I would take the models that I've built, put them in the model, and then simulate it. So I had to categorize all spaces, common spaces found in ships, and then model them. Since ships change their location, as I said before, instead of having one yearly climate for one location, I had to develop climates that represent the areas at which the ship crosses. Then I did some. I modeled the heat transfer between the ship hull and seawater, and the solar radiation that was reflected in the seawater. The casual gains in most common spaces were categorized and modeled. So instead of asking every time go on board and monitor and say that who occupies this space and for how long, the most common spaces were investigated and reference values were produced. Then I modeled the change in location orientation during simulations. So with an input file, you could say that at this time of simulation, the ship rotates, the model rotates by 5 degrees. And I modeled the most common HVAC system configurations that are found on board ships. Now, as I told you, David, you can see here that you have mild steel, galvanized steel. This is a bit to expand on the materials and the construction, the constructions that are found on board ships. So you have glass wool and rock wool for insulation, PVC on the floor, subfloor compound. So by selecting some of these, you could see here there's construction, a very common construction, an A60 bulkhead external construction. It's comprised by this material, which has these thermal properties with this thickness. I'm pretty sure you get the idea. Then this is a slide showing the modules for the common spaces found on board. So the heat transfer was modeled, taking into consideration the ship speed and the seawater temperature, while the sea reflectivity, the state of the sea was taken into consideration, which means the radiation that was reflected is a function of the wind speed, which means like how much it, presents waves on the sea and how this affects the reflectivity of the solar radiation. Now, with the modeling tool at hand, the other problem was that the ship accommodation, especially in passenger ships and cruise liners, are very complex. So I did two things to address this problem. The first thing was to topologically decouple the spaces, which means that if only space 2 is under consideration, I don't want to model everything because that will take forever. Ideally, I would have everything and the boundary conditions will be the environment. So what I did, instead of modeling everything, I investigated what will happen if I only model space 2 and I use the conditions inside the space of the previous time step as the boundary condition. This is the figure that, this is the model that I used. You can see here the measure that was used to compare how much accuracy is lost was the heat that was required in order to condition this space. So you can see here that if I compare the power that was required for a very detailed model with the power that was required if this assumption was made, I could quantify the loss of accuracy. By doing that, I found out which common space configurations can be actually topologically decoupled from the rest of the accommodation. Now the next thing, especially during early design, was to group spaces. So when we were talking about the whole deck of a ship, ideally I wouldn't want to model everything. I would just want a huge box. That would be very easy for me. It would require just drawing a box with the windows. So what I did was gradually starting merging spaces and quantifying the loss of accuracy during this grouping process, so that I would go from this to this very simple model. This would take about a day to model, while this would take a few minutes. Again, I investigated decks found in the superstructures, in cargo ships, and also some common configurations in cruise liners. Now, with all this information, the paper introduces a case study where in the first step, a heat load calculation is performed, which means quantifying the amount of heat that is lost or gained during cold or hot conditions. And then actual component sizing, which means modeling both the accommodation and the equipment, the HVAC equipment, with PID controllers and everything. So each zone, as you can see here, so this is comprised by seven merged zones or grouped zones, as I described before. So each zone was maintained between this range, 22 to 27 degrees Celsius, with an ideal controller, which meant the moment the temperature fell below or went above that, the power requirements, the heat that should be introduced to stay in this range was quantified. Two weekly simulations were run with a 30-minute time step. I used the extreme hot and cold ambient conditions to quantify the loss of heat. However, it should be noted that if the area of operation is very well defined, and we know that a ship is going to operate in a certain area, extreme conditions might be skipped, and the actual conditions can be used in order not to oversize the systems. So this is what you get. You can see the variation of power in time. So this is how much heat is lost or gained from the spaces to the environment or vice versa. This can be used in order to, you can have a more accurate assessment of the heat losses in order to then size the HVAC systems. Now if you want to model everything, this can be done as well. So in detailed design, in order to actually size the components on board, the whole HVAC system was modeled. So you have 30% of fresh air going into the air handling unit. The air handling unit, you can see here that maintains the temperature within this range. Then the air is applied to the accommodation where heat is lost or gained. Then it goes to the return ducts, is recirculated, and 70% of the air is again enters this mixing box here. Okay, thank you. Yeah, I think I'll get there soon. So that's what you get after running the simulations for this model. You can quantify the actual capacity of the heater and the cooler of this specific configuration here. And of course, you get many metrics from the simulation. So you get the temperatures in each zone during both simulations that were run. You can check if they are within the comfort range, as they are here. And of course, later on, if you want to make sure that everything can be done with a formal optimization process, you can actually apply an optimization and say that if temperatures exceed a certain range, then change a parameter, run simulation again, until you get the optimum operating points and capacity for the equipment. So to conclude, ship energy systems are characterized by inefficient design. Only recently, the focus of the shipping industry switched to energy efficiency. Energy modeling and simulation can be used and can improve the energy performance of ships. Building energy simulation, once marinized, it can be used to accurately assess the energy performance of ships. And there is a need for validation of this certain tool that has been developed, which can be done if the results are compared with onboard monitor data from hotel loads and equipment operation onboard ships. So that was all. Thank you. Any questions? Okay, you go first.
One question. Is this that it's not part of the of having the power plant that you say electricity against the condition? You have to take with the power plant and be against a lot of the power plants.
Yes.
How have you, considered the compartments as close, differently than as close to the major group?
Yeah, so when I was doing this study here, one of the common space configurations that I used was a cabin which is adjacent to an engine room. So then I assumed, instead of modeling the whole engine room in time, I assumed conditions of 40 degrees Celsius, which is kind of real, especially in cargo ships. And then I quantified how much accuracy will be lost if the, let's say, if the engine room is not actually modeled. So the, let's say, the connection is not actually performed. Yes, sir, I didn't, there wasn't enough space in the paper to present all the findings, but I can send you everything if you want and see the outcome of this comparison. But yeah, actually, yeah, to answer to your question, yeah, when you have spaces, you can't just assume similar conditions. You need to say, you need to assume that the space that is adjacent to the cabin has a temperature of around 40 degrees or 41, if I remember correctly, from the outcome of, from the results of this study. Sorry? Yeah, exactly, exactly. Yes, if you want to be correct, there is, again, the tool is there to model everything if you want. You can model the engine room, you can model the heat that is radiated from the equipment inside. But I didn't go that far, you know, specifically for the engine room. But it's something that can be done, yes.
Did I understand well that in terms of energy, at least in your test case, it is more costly to heat the space against to cool it? Because I think
yes, so this is the heat. Okay, in this case, this is the heat local calculation, which means heat that is that you require. Yeah, so heat that is lost from the envelope, let's say, of the accommodation. Since I used extreme cold ambient conditions, we are talking about -20, if I remember correctly. Yeah, so this means that you have -20, and you need to maintain it in at least 22 degrees inside. So you would expect. Yeah, exactly. But when we're talking about heating, we have 35 degrees of ambient temperature. And again, I didn't use a single point. I used a climate file, which was a typical cold climate file. So the temperature would range from -20 going up to 5. This is where you see, you know, these variations. Yes, again, it wasn't, yeah, one point. It was, as I said, a variation in time. But as I, yeah, as I said after that, if you know exactly where the ship is going to operate, which is difficult, as our friend there from Royal Caribbean will tell us, that the ship might be in the Caribbean for a few months and then go up to Norway. Yes. But yeah, the focus on this paper is providing the tools in order to do all those calculations. Yes, it can be used during these calculations. And in cruise liners, I think the only space, accommodation spaces underwater are for the crew, right? Yes, I mean, yeah, I know what you mean. As a part of my PhD, I did it in case it's someone wants, maybe in the future, to actually calculate the heat loss. But yeah, as you said, it's only a small portion. Yeah, that as well. But yeah, that will be modeling the whole tank and the fluid inside, which would be oil, and then calculate how much heat you is required in order to heat it, to preheat it, to enter the main engine. Yeah, my work focused on the hotel loads. Yeah, as a member of a dynamic energy modeling team in the University of Strathclyde, there were other people who, there was one guy who was doing modeling of the main engine, so combustion modeling. Someone else was doing the hydraulics. And the main idea behind all this was to develop a holistic ship energy model where all those systems would interact with each other under certain operating and boundary conditions and assess the whole energy performance of the whole thing. All of this is difficult because you have so many systems on board. And the outcome of the project so far of two European projects has been an onboard decision support tool. It hasn't been extensively validated yet, but this is the way forward. It's slowly getting there. Okay. Thank you very much.